stesso o devo stare fisso
No,
immobile?
no, no, no.
Cioè riesco anche se cammino un
Sì,
pochino.
sì. Questa è l'inquadratura, per esempio,
Sì,
quando tu
sì.
praticamente sei andato avanti.
Ah,
Sì,
a voglia, voglia.
può muoversi tranquillamente. Però direi soltanto di tirare le luci verso. Allora, se ti spegni, anzi, così ci facciamo una due routine. Sì, così si vede anche le
Perfetto.
slide, si vedono abbastanza bene. Anzi, facciamo
No, ma tanto
pure
poi le slide gliele lascio,
una.
se
Ok,
vuoi. Sì,
perfetto.
sì.
Serve inquadrare la lavagna? Ok.
Può darsi che io due cose le debba disegnare, ma insomma mi sembra che si vede, no?
È soltanto un lato, ma metto pure l'altro.
Ecco, magari sì, uso, ammesso che lo debba fare per l'angolino. Oh, poi ti dicevo. Che mia moglie continua a chiamare dei bambini,
allora,
non lo fa la terza
funziona tutto anche sul cellulare, grazie.
Fa la terza ricerca. Ma quale dei bambini? Ma quale bambini?
Formation of fountains and bunch of stuff all regarding how galaxy forms and why they have the shape they did have. So I asked Luca to give us a talk regarding which are the signatures of dark matter in the astrophysical context, especially in the galaxy dynamics, because this is something that usually people are used to take for guaranteed. But there are many subtleties that it's better to know before to assume that the dark matter paradigm is wrong. So Luca, thanks a lot.
Thank you, Giovanni. Thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure, of course, to be here. Unfortunately, I have a terrible flu, so I need some. And I hope I will be able to transfer a few concepts that I think are quite important. So please, if you have questions, you can stop with questions. I am not sure I will answer to your questions, but I will try. So, what's the basic idea of my talk of today? Well, it's a sort of experiment. It's a sort of an experiment, yes. It's a dark matter. So the idea is to have the talk in four parts. So, and the first two parts, I think, should be quite interesting for people outside the astronomy field, because I will try to summarize a few facts, empirical facts, about the evidences we think we have about dark matter on galactic scales, and I will try to present and clarify a few, unfortunately, quite common misconceptions people have about these evidences, and unfortunately, some of these misconceptions we just transfer to students, with the idea to make the argument simple. Actually, we are not doing a good work. And then in the second part of the talk, I will give you some aspect of classical mode. So you know mode is a modifier of Newtonian dynamics. And it's a very interesting idea. I think is wrong, but is wrong, is not easy to prove that mode is wrong. And this is a quite interesting property of mode, because you know, when a theory is really wrong, it should be quite easy to rule it out of the theory, okay? So we know that Aristotelian physics is wrong. It's quite easy after Galileo to show that the Aristotelian physics is wrong. Well, with mode, I think almost all we agree that mode is wrong. But right now, we do not have yet a clear-cut example of why Mond is wrong. So I think Mond is wrong. But for example, maybe you heard about the bullet cluster. Okay, so we have bullet cluster, so Mond is wrong. Actually, the bullet cluster was more a problem for standard gravity. So let's start. So I will show quite fast 3 points that are not so straightforward as they appear. So the problem of flat rotation pools of these galaxies may be the standard argument to see, look, there is dark matter. Then, two less known empirical facts, the velocity dispersion profiles in elliptical galaxies, and the structure of the hot gaseous atmosphere of an elliptical galaxy. Okay, you can use actually all these three phenomenological observations to argue that dark matter exists, but it's not so easy as usually. So here you have the standard picture. You know, you have a galaxy, and you have the visible matter in the galaxy. You take a Newtonian gravity and you calculate and you draw the red line. This is what you expect the matter, the velocity of the visible mass. Okay. Then you measure in the visible part, of course, you measure the visible stuff. In the invisible part, you measure the H21 line of the cold hydrogen. And so you can measure the rotational velocity at distances larger than the optical size of the galaxy. Okay? And clearly, you see there is a huge discrepancy between the calculator, the red line, and the observer. So what you say to the students? Well, this you presented the students with this what I call a common textbook explanation. What's the common explanation? You say, you take the student and say, look, let's assume there is a spherical symmetric field. We use the second Newton theory that all we know, okay? When you have a sphere, the gravity field is just produced by the mass inside the sphere. You ask to have a flat rotation curve, and then you say, look, beautiful. The dark matter, we have a spherical symmetric dark matter distribution. That for some reason that I will not enter is called the isothermal dark matter halo. Okay? So this is the standard urban legend we teach to students. But things are much more complicated. Because, as I will try to convince you, when you remove the assumption of spherical symmetry, well, we may have something that I call effect without a cause. In other words, we could have an almost perfectly flat rotation curve without dark matter. So you may think, well, maybe dark matter is just a consequence of our love for spherical symmetry. And this, of course, is just hand-waving. You know, if you move from spherical symmetry, the mathematics behind the gravitational potential is more complex. You need Bessel functions, Hankel Fourier transform, all this stuff that astronomers have been doing the last century, or 200 centuries. So you do to this something not trivial. Well, why am I telling this? Because, for example, you can show that an incredibly stupid toy model, which is called the Mestel disk, okay? This is a thin disk, okay? There is no Z density, just on the equatorial plane. And the surface density of the disk is 1 over R, where R is the cylindrical radius. Well, if you compute the gravitational field of this object, that of course you cannot compute by using the second Newton theorem, because it's not a sphere, well, you can show, it's a back to the envelope computation, if you know something about Bessel function, that this object has a perfectly flat rotation curve. So, I know this is a toy model, but the concept is quite important. In other words, if for some case I would have a purely stellar galaxy, disk galaxy, Mestel disk, I will observe a perfectly flat rotation without dark matter.
But until the optical radius, so up to the optical radius.
Oh, this is a completely artificial object, and there is no truncation radius. So you have an infinite system with the density because in disks also the outer part influences the inner rotation curve, because the second Newton theorem does not hold for this. Okay. So you need an infinite system, but this is the concept of what is important. You may have a perfectly flat rotation curve without a dark matter halo. Of course, real galaxies are not in the stellar disk, but this is the minor point here. But this is not all the history. For example, we could explore a family of more realistic objects. For example, power law ellipsoidal distribution. The theory of ellipsoidal figures of equilibrium is goes back to Newton. Newton, Maclaurin, Riemann, Hilbert, Chandrasekhar, Jacobi, Dirichlet, all names that people in this room know. Everything, every one of these very important physicists and mathematicians worked on this, on the gravitational field of rotating structures of equilibrium. So we know almost everything, okay? We have beautiful formulae. You can find everything you like on a book by Chandrasekhar, Ellipsoidal Figures of Equilibrium. Now let's see if I can go back to the presentation. Okay. So this is, of course, I'm not intending that you even if you read this is not important. But what's the concept? Well, the concept is if you take an oblate ellipsoid with the density declining as 1/n², where n is the ellipsoidal radius, where you get again a perfectly flat rotation curve. Okay? So note that this gamma 2 power law ellipsoid in the spherical case is just the isothermal sphere. And what is curious, and this curiosity will not end here, if you take this power law ellipsoid and you flatten on the equatorial plane in projection, you get the Mestel disk, okay? What I am saying is that the three objects I presented to you right now, the isothermal sphere, the power law ellipsoid, and the Mestel disk, where all the family of power law gamma equal to ellipsoids flattened on the equatorial plane, they are the Mestel disk. And all these objects, they have a perfectly flat rotation curve. But this is not the end of the history. You can construct some much more complicated object by using some method. This is just a little publicity. With Giuseppe Bertin at the Scuola Normale, we built a family of torii, okay? Very strange objects, like a torus, okay? And this very simple power law torus, this is very surprising. You have the analytical potential, this is very strange. And this is the rotation curve of this torus in the equatorial plane. And please look, if you take alpha equal 4, you get a perfectly flat rotation curve. Okay, so in our torus, self-gravitating torus for alpha equal 4, you get the flat rotation curve. And guess what happens? Oh, these are just projections. So you see, the objects are very strange. Well, if you project these torus on the equatorial plane, you get again the Mestel disk. So let me say in red that I have a conjecture that is completely independent of the dark matter, but I like this conjecture. Well, we may conjecture that all systems that in projections are the Mestel disk, they have a flat rotation curve. Because all objects I am aware of with a flat rotation curve in projection, they are the Mestel disk. But, so this closed the, so what's the message? The message is the following. From the astrophysical point of view, we have several examples, artificial, okay? But we have examples. of systems, showing that in principle a flat rotation is not just by looking at the flat rotation the final proof of the presence of dark matter. I have no figures here, but please, this is a very important point. We have a more realistic case. This is the real astrophysical information. We take exponential disks, because if you look to galaxies, real galaxies, the stars, the distribution of stars is like an exponential disk. Okay, so now I am talking about real galaxies. Well, if you compute the rotation curve within an exponential disk, what we get is the following. In the optical region of a pure exponential disk, with pure, I mean without dark matter, we almost have a flat rotation curve. No need of dark matter from stellar dynamics inside the galactic disk. In other words, what I am telling you is that these galaxies would end with the stars. There is no need of dark matter, even if the rotation curve would be almost flat, okay? And if this was shown very clearly in a shock meeting by a great astrophysicist, Arvish Kalmajis, in 76. And this was a shock because Vera Rubin, you know, Vera Rubin, she is known as the people who discovered dark matter in spiral galaxies. But the work of Vera Rubin was limited to the optical disk. So Vera Rubin just used a wrong computation of the gravitational field. Okay? You cannot prove anything about dark matter just looking to the rotation curve in the optical disk, because if you compute properly the gravitational field, the rotation curve is almost perfect. So, what? This is the logical path to the need of dark matter. So, a flat rotation curve in the optical disk of galaxies is not indication of dark matter. However, a stellar gaseous disk is not the solution of the problem. Why? Because if you have an infinitesimally thin disk supported by almost circular orbits, this disk is unstable by m equal 1 modes. The instability is called a bar mode instability. And the only way to stabilize disk is to have round potentials. In other words, you need something like a gravitational external field, otherwise the disk breaks.
What is the time of this instability? What is the dynamical time scale of this instability?
Oh, very fast. It's of the order of, say, 100 million years.
Nothing.
Yeah, 1% of the age of the universe. So we have a striker people stability against body stability. In other words, you could think, well, but maybe I have a dark matter disk. Suppose dark matter is a Mestel dark matter disk. Well, this does not work because a Mestel disk is unstable. So we need an almost spherical gravitational field. Now we know this, after all these kind of arguments. We need an almost spherical gravitational field. We got a distance, high distance from the optical disk, where the gravitational field is certainly dominated by the monopole, and so it is spherical. And so almost isothermal and spheroidal dark matter halos are required, but not just because the rotation curve is flat within the stellar disk. But why? Because disks are stable and are well outside the end of the optical disk, the rotation curve in the H1 line is flat. Okay? So this is the first point. elliptical galaxies are not like stellar bits. Orbits inside elliptical galaxies are something like, elliptical galaxies are systems almost pressure supported. All stellar orbits are very chaotic. We have a velocity dispersion tensor. In other words, you can imagine from this point of view elliptical galaxies as supported by velocity dispersion of stars. So actually we do not have here a rotational velocity. So these galaxies do not have cold gas, so we do not have H1 observations, very little. What we can observe is the velocity dispersion of stars. Put in other words, we can observe something like the temperature of stars, how fast stars are moving randomly. Okay? We have equations, we can solve the equations, and what do we get? Well, if you take a toy model, a spherical galaxy, and you put the stars moving in a quasi-isothermal, in an isothermal halo, you get a constant velocity dispersion. So the message here is the following. If you have an isothermal halo, circular orbits are constant, but also velocity dispersion of stars is expected to remain constant. Okay, so now velocity dispersion is the analogous of rotational curves in galactic disks, okay? So, you say, good, now we can observe velocity dispersion of in elliptical galaxies. And the modeling of Jeans equations is extremely sophisticated, at least in astronomy, okay? We can do very beautiful models, very beautiful. Not only spherically symmetric, of course, but also axisymmetric, with a very, very complicated dynamical structure. So please, I hope I'm not offending anyone here, but I wrote this. The message here is for particle physicists in particular. Be aware that the dynamical modeling and understanding of dynamics in astrophysics is by far deep. That you will ever imagine. Why I spend 1 minute to write this sentence? Because on AstroPH, sometimes papers on dark matter written by people doing particle physics appear. And the level of dynamical modeling is something of the elementary school. So I am completely ignorant about particle physics, except to know that there are particles, okay? But there are very famous names writing that they have the model of dark matter with the rotation curve. Very big names that I will not repeat here because there is a registration, but you can look on AstroPH. And then you look at what you say, that these very, very big names, they comes out with 1/r². So this is undergraduate physics for first year astronomy student. It's not even correct. Okay, so I think before approaching this field, a serious reading of the literature would be highly recommended, just to see, just to understand where the field of dynamical modeling it is now, okay? We are building a galaxy model with three integral distribution functions based on Stecker coordinates, ellipsoidal coordinates in phase space, okay? So we are not doing spheres. So this is the message. So work on dark matter, but please read also what astronomers have been doing in the last century. Because I am not sure that you know, the first explicit reference to dark matter, when it was made in astronomy, it is incredible, was a statement made by Henri Poincaré. Okay, Poincaré. working, discussing on the motion of stars near the sun in a letter, Poincaré, so maybe the best of classical physicists, saying, maybe we need some invisible mass here. Okay. So that matter is a very, very long subject. However, what is the problem? The problem is that even elliptical galaxies, the velocity dispersion is not the last word about dark matter detection. Why? Because you may have dynamical effects that give you a flat velocity dispersion profile within dark matter. And you may wonder how it is possible. Well, it is possible because the stars, the elliptical galaxies are, you know, perfectly what I am saying, are collisionless systems. And the temperature of stars is not described by an isotropic tensor. Okay? Stars are hotter in some direction and colder in some other direction. After all, the system is collisionless. The relaxation time of elliptical galaxies is billions of times the age of the universe. Not hundreds, billions of times the age of the universe. So you have stars that move faster in one direction and slower in the other direction. Because there is no time for thermodynamics to start to work. We need to wait other billions of times the age of the universe. And then what can happen in a galaxy? Well, you may have the so-called tangential anisotropy. You have orbits hotter in the tangential direction. Now, suppose this is the galaxy center, and you have a lot of orbits on tangential anisotropy. When you look along the line of sight, along the line of sight, at distance from the center, you are looking all the complete velocity, tangential velocity. And so you think, the astronomers say, oh, look how big is the velocity dispersion. But this is not the velocity dispersion. This is the whole component of the velocity vector. So this is artificially hard in the external regions, just by projection effects, not because there is dark matter that makes a star moving faster. Okay? And the opposite can happen in the central regions. If you have radial anisotropy, so stars that move faster along the radial direction, now you observe very low velocity dispersion in the outer, lower than the real velocity dispersion. And in the center, when you look all the stars that are moving along your line of sight, you measure incredibly high velocity dispersion. Okay? You have the opposite effect. So the fact that elliptical galaxies are collisionless systems makes the use of the velocity dispersion not unique. And in fact, in stellar dynamics, I have the systems here. This is a very simple system where we show that you can have dark matter mass with no changes in the central velocity dispersion. So, in principle, you may have the two opposite situations, to have a flat rotation curve without dark matter, and to have a low velocity dispersion with dark matter. So the name of this strange thing I told you is called mass anisotropy degeneracy. When you observe an elliptical galaxy, in principle, you do not know if you are observing a galaxy with a lot of dark matter and isotropic velocity dispersion, or a galaxy without dark matter with a lot of tangential anisotropy. So it's not a definite proof of velocity dispersion. We need some more complicated information. And in fact, this is one of the fields in which I work. Well, I will not enter this. But the only proper way to understand velocity dispersion in elliptical galaxies is to use phase space. You cannot just use Jeans equations. You need something more deep. You need the collisionless Boltzmann equation that maybe you know as the name as a Vlasov equation. Okay? In other words, elliptical galaxies cannot be described as a fluid. There is the same difference you have between fluidodynamics and kinetic theory. The only proper way to describe an elliptical galaxy is with the kinetic. So you have all problems that certain people working on particles know. And we have some general theorem, very beautiful, we proved quite recently, 10 years ago, quite powerful. So we know a lot about dark matter, also in elliptical galaxies. Maybe we even know the preferred directions in which dark matter particles should move. And then let me point out the final empirical evidence that people believe is an evidence of dark matter. And so it are the hot gaseous atmospheres of dark galaxies. For some reason that I will not enter, elliptical galaxies are embedded in hot gas halos. This gas is produced by stellar evolution. And so at the end you have the atmosphere of gas emitting synchrotron by essentially by Bremsstrahlung and essentially by Bremsstrahlung, because it's a hot gas. It's a plasma, completely ionized. And so what's the idea? The idea is to use, again, a theorem of Poincaré, very beautiful theorem. Very beautiful, very general, and very powerful. The Poincaré theorem say that if you are in hydrostatic equilibrium, pressure, density, temperature are all stratified on isopotential surfaces. Okay, this is a theorem. If you are in hydrostatic equilibrium, if you have a galaxy with stars and dark matter, and then you put gas in this galaxy, the galaxy, if the gas is at equilibrium, in hydrostatic equilibrium, the only way to be in equilibrium is that density, temperature, pressure, entropy, everything must be stratified on the total potential. But this is very interesting for astronomers. Why? Because if you take rho, and you do rho squared, and you just multiply rho squared by some function of temperature, for example, square
ordinary matter.
Yes, I'm talking of electrons in the interstellar.
Okay. Just know what I mean. There is in principle BBM limits that could constrain.
Yes. No. We are using elementary physics.
I thought this is.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So you have a question. So in principle, what's the idea? In principle, we can reconstruct the total potential and by subtraction obtain the amount and distribution of dark matter, okay? Because we observe the total potential. We compute the potential of the stars, and what remains is the dark matter. This is a very naive, astronomers are quite naive. Okay. But also here we have a problem, because gas motions can mimic the presence of dark matter, okay? All I told before is for hydrostatic equilibrium. But suppose the gas is moving, and we know that in elliptical galaxies, the gas is moving. We have gas flows. We have cooling flows with the gas flowing inside. And we have galactic winds. So the atmospheres of elliptical galaxies are not in hydrostatic equilibrium. And so also in this case, we have a terrible bias against a robust measure of dark matter. I am talking of stellar matter. course, there are other methods. You can use gravitational lensing, for example. And in fact, we have several systems that, after a careful modelization based on rotation curves, anisotropy, velocity dispersion, hot gas properties, at the end, we can be quite sure that dark matter should be there. Okay, but so the message of this part of the talk, I know I am quite long, but I think these are very important messages. So in other words, dark matter is not something like you go outside, you see the sun. Okay, there is the sun, yes. Okay, there is dark matter, no. To be sure, you need a careful and not easy work of stellar dynamics, observations, fluid dynamics. Gas moves in galaxies. You have winds produced by supernovae. Look, these are simulations I did with some students. You have the black holes at the center of the galaxies that produce outflows of gas. Of course, the density and temperature in a gas outflow is different that in an hydrostatic atmosphere. And then, if we are wrong, and we use the hydrostatic equilibrium to describe a situation which is not in equilibrium, you get wrong numbers, because all the kinetic terms are ignored. Okay? So, now I will tell two things about the model. Okay, so I am quite happy about this. But let me finish from the first part. What my idea about the first part was the following. To show that detection on astronomical scales of dark matter is not so easy. After we understand that it's not so easy, I can tell you that we are pretty sure that the galaxies have a lot of dark matter. But not just by elementary argument, because people did a lot of work. What about MOD? Well, standard gravity has problems. For example, the first point was the discussion. So observational evidences that if Newtonian gravity is correct in the Newtonian model are not easy, okay? Are not so straightforward. It's not a closed argument. There is a conspiracy. I did not mention this point. But for some reason, when you do dark matter modeling in galaxies, for some reason, dark matter and baryons seems to talk very well. So dark matter starts to be important exactly where baryons start to vanish. Well, of course, the standard answer is, well, but they interact gravitationally, so maybe there is some mechanism. Well, it's not trivial, this. And finally, this is the point that I am ignorant. As far as I know, nobody knows what dark matter is made of. So, the idea in MOD was to say that after all, on cosmological scales, Newtonian gravity is not the correct description of gravity. And of course, the first idea was to modify the strength of the gravitational field instead of 1 over r squared, for example, as 1 over r. Because of course, if the gravitational force is 1 over r, you get a perfectly flat rotation curve around a point mass, because you have v square over r proportional 1 over r, v square constant. But you can show that this cannot work, because galaxies do not obey to such a law. The Tully-Fisher relation would be completely wrong. Okay? So we have an empirical observation that would be completely wrong. You cannot modify gravity just modifying the exponent in the 1 over r force. You need something more complicated. And this, incredible, this more complicated modelization was found in the 80s by Milgrom and Weckenstein. Mond is a non-linear theory. This is the field equation. It can be derived by Lagrangian. So it's a serious theory. I mean, this is a serious theory. It's not a joke. Okay? We have a differential equation. This is how particles should move in the gravitational field. In the deep Mond regime, you get this equation. As always happens in mathematics, if you go to talk with some people working on elliptical differential equations, they say, oh, but this is a very interesting problem. The name of this operator is a P Laplace operator. So you are happy. You say, oh, please tell me everything about the P Laplace and its solutions. And they say, oh, we know everything. Please, they say, what's the dimension you are interested in? Because we know everything in all dimensions. And you say, well, I am a poor astronomer, I am interested in three-dimensional space. And they say, oh, but the three-dimensional space is the only space where almost no theorems are known. So, mathematicians can tell you properties of this operator in R5. Incredible, beautiful theorem. You ask in R3, well, this is a limit, and so mathematicians do not know much more than astronomers right now about this equation. And I will leave you the presentation. So you can look to. So the question is that if you apply all this machinery, let me just point out this line. This is a key problem of Mond, to obtain predictions in Mond. Because suppose you believe to the Mond field equation. So we have a density and we have two different views of the universe, Mond view and Newtonian view. So what's the potential in the Newtonian view? Well, is the standard Poisson equation. But if the real world is Mond, then the operator is this or this, okay? But the density is the same. And so you can subtract the two equations, recognize that you have something like divergence of something equals zero. That something, the name S is completely casual, something is the curl of some other vector field. So Mond and Newtonian gravity, the potentials, are related to a solenoidal unknown field. Okay? We can prove that in spherical symmetry, the field S vanishes. So in spherical symmetry, actually we can do some calculation in Mond. But outside spherical symmetry, calculations in Mond are incredibly complicated. Why? Because the operator is not linear. And so all the machinery available in standard gravity and in electromagnetism, expansion, orthogonal functions, all these in very important technical tools in mathematics cannot adopt it here. Because in Mond, the sum of two solutions is not a solution, because the operator is not linear. And let me say that Mond is embarrassing. Here you see black dots, okay? Oh, these are real galaxies. These are not only Mond, okay? NGC 4138, blah, blah, blah. The dots are the observations, okay? The solid line, the black solid line, look here. The black solid line is the mode prediction just by observing the stellar distribution. Okay? Here, I do not have dark matter halos that I can add or subtract until the data are reproduced. Mond gay is terrible. Mond is a beautiful theory, because Mond has the property, the incredible property, to be wrong. And this property of a theory is not common in modern physics, to have a theory that can be clearly proved wrong. Because if I found a single galaxy, don't look to this because this is another problem that I cannot enter. But if I found a single galaxy that I can believe the data, I apply MOND and I found that a black cool different from data, MOND is dead. Just a single case. Right now there is not a single case of a disk galaxy where the application of the MOND theory gives the wrong rotation code. And I think this is a very strong argument in favor of MOND. And look this. Can you believe this? So the dots are the data. Then you take the barriers, the stars, I don't remember what's of this. You have even the small glitches in the rotation curves that are reproduced. This is astonishing. And what's the present situation? Of course, I will not enter in the present situation. In Bologna, we did a lot of work. We did some analytical work with the Zeo. We were able to prove some very strange theorem that holds not only for Poisson equation, but also for the Laplace and a lot of theorems by Kuzmin on ellipsoidal systems. We developed a numerical code. We have a numerical code, we can do numerical simulations. This was a real breakthrough in the theory, because now we can do merging of galaxies in MOND. And this, I will finish with this, because this, I think, is an idea I had after attending a talk by Milo. And I realized that maybe we can prove is completely wrong. And we did a paper, I thought about my idea with James Binney. Binney realized that my idea was very smart, but what I did was completely wrong. And so we did the work together by using some more complicated mathematical techniques. And let me just explain why I think MOND is wrong. This is the wrong explanation, the simple explanation of the idea I have. Suppose you have a stellar system like an elliptical galaxy, and MOND is the correct gravitational theory, okay, not a Newtonian theory. Then you compute the two-body relaxation time of this galaxy. How it works, the two-body relaxation time, you know very well. You have the Coulomb logarithm. Why you have the Coulomb logarithm? Because you have particles, you have the long distance interactions, okay? The orbit of each particle is modified by long distance interaction. And the long distance interactions are weighted by the impact parameter. So you get, at the end, you get an integral and you understand that the thermodynamics relaxation is due not to the few short distance encounters, but to the many long distance encounters. Now suppose mond is correct. If you take mond, the monopole expansion on mond, the gravitational field is 1 over r, is not 1 over r squared. And if you do the average over the impact parameter, what you obtain? That mond systems are enormously more collisional than Newtonian systems, because the force is 1 over r at large distances, is not 1 over r squared. And when you sum, you add all the interactions, you get something terrible. All elliptical galaxies should be relaxed, and they are not relaxed. This was my wrong argument. I think it was smart, but was wrong. Because, why was wrong? Because the gravitational potential in mond is a logarithmic potential, because the field is 1 over r. But in a logarithmic potential, you cannot have unbound orbits coming from infinity and going to infinity, because the potential where the depth is infinite. So all orbits in mond are limited. And you can do a trivial kinetic analog of Newtonian gravity mode. So with James Binney, we applied the fluctuation dissipation theorem that holds independent, you know, of the interaction force. And we obtained that the situation is a little bit less dramatic than what I computed. But yet, for example, we found that no globular clusters should be orbiting around dwarf galaxies. But we see a lot of globular clusters around the dwarf galaxies. Not only. Look this. This is a simulation we did in Bologna. This is time. And here you have the bar angular frequency, because in mond, not only the two-body relaxation time is much shorter than in Newtonian gravity, but also the dynamical friction time is much shorter. Look, here you have two disk galaxies with a bar in the middle, set to rotate with an assigned initial angular velocity. This is a slowing down of the bar in Newtonian gravity. This is the slowing down of the bar in mond, which is much faster, because by the equipartition theorem, the dynamical friction time and the two-body relaxation time are related. So a first consequence of our finding that the two-body relaxation time is short is that also dynamical friction time. And this was one of the most exciting results of my career. This is a very little result. But to have a theory or something that you imagine, you did the analytical computation, you build the code, you do the simulation, and you see that the differential equation do what you expected, well, it's quite nice. Also, phase mixing behaves quite different. So here you have phase in mond, a phase in phase in Newtonian gravity. So mond is much less mixing than Newtonian gravity. So here is almost the opposite of what I told you about dark matter. So I was quite negative about dark matter. And at the end, I said, well, but I think dark matter is there. Here I was much more optimistic. I say, mond is beautiful, we can do, and I think mond is wrong. Not only by this argument, but look, it's like to have your wife is not in is a bad situation. Why? Because Monde is a non-linear field. It's non-linear. It means the following. If I have a binary star, with a very large distance between the two stars, and the Monde is correct, this star, this binary star, will orbit with a very long, okay? But if I take this binary star, and I will put this binary star in an elevator on a gravitational vertical field higher than the critical acceleration value of Monde, the tail will fall, and we all expect to be unable to see that we are in free fall. But the gravitational equation of Monde is nonlinear. And so if you are a binary in free fall, the total acceleration is the binary interaction plus the gravitational field of the free fall, because it's a nonlinear theory. You cannot add and subtract arbitrary values of the acceleration. And so immediately, the binary star will start to move in another way. So in other words, Monde does not obey to the strong equivalence principle. And I think this, for a standard physicist, is the final word about Monde. So the two-body relaxation time maybe is just an argument by some people in Bologna, or quite irrelevant. But Monde is nonlinear. It means in Monde you can distinguish free falling systems. And I think, at least I am not ready to accept this. Maybe we should accept this. Anyway. So the conclusion is, there are a lot of empirical facts in favor of Monde, in my opinion. And there are a few major objections against Monde. But we were not able right now to find the smoking gun, I say, case to say Monde is wrong. The bullet cluster, they say, oh, is wrong. Actually, the velocity, when they showed the first data of bullet cluster, they say the shock, the Mach number of the shock is around 3, maybe I'm wrong, 3 or 4. Immediately, I say, here we have a problem. Why? Because in Newtonian gravity, if you fall from infinity, you can't produce a shock stronger than 2. Because the average escape velocity is twice the virial velocity, the virial velocity of the system. You can't. And if they say that within the bullet cluster there is a shock of Mach number 3, this is trivial. Is trivial. Why? Because you have the logarithmic potential. You can fall with whatever relative velocity you like. You have an infinite energy mode. You do not have unbound orbits for the same reason. And in fact, when I say this, people start to laugh, what you say. But after a few weeks, a lot of papers start to appear on AstroPH, saying, we have to look carefully in the numerical simulations because it's not clear if in the standard cold dark matter scenario we can get merging with such high relative velocity. And at the end, they found one in the simulation. And they say, phew. And now there are more than one case of high velocity encounters. So Monde will solve this problem. So I will stop it.
If you need more observations.
one of seven cases. And so, of course, if you look in the simulations at the end, some you can find some special case. It depends on the initial conditions. It depends if you have a three-body encounter. You can do something with the Newtonian gravity to produce mergings with a relative velocity higher than Mach 2. You can do something. But certainly this is completely natural in mode. It's not a problem at all. If I have just 1 minute, you could say about bullet cluster. Well, but the argument against mode is that if you look to the bullet cluster, you see that you have two strong gravitational fields. So the idea is that the gas is meshed together and the dark matter. And you say you cannot do this with the mode. This is completely false, because outside the spherical symmetry, you have the solenoidal field S. And if you look at what corresponds in the Newtonian gravity, you see that you can produce phantom excess of gravitational field in when you are outside the spherical symmetry, where you do not have baryons. So it is not true that the fact that you have baryons here and two blobs of gravitational field here, this is impossible for mode to reproduce. It's not easy, but it's not impossible. If you do not believe me, well, you believe this experiment. Suppose you have a point mass, and you say that the point mass is producing a mode field. So you have 1 over r. The field is 1 over r, and the potential is log. Agree? Then I take the Laplace operator of log r. So I am doing Newtonian gravity. And this is different from zero in all points of the space. So in other words, if you have a point mass with the mode potential, and you look to the reality with Newtonian glasses, you say there is a huge dark matter here. But you have the dark matter where you have not the baryons. And this is exactly what happens outside the spherical symmetry in the bullet cluster. So the first part of the talk is not so easy to say that dark matter is there. We believe that dark matter. In the second part of the talk, the final comment is not so easy to kill
evidence supporting dark matter in the context of dynamics.
They are strong. They are strong, but not trivial. So what happened to the cosmic microwave background with the mode? Unfortunately, I think that right now we can have only some guess, because as far as I know, there is no way right now to do a proper, for example, numerical mode simulation in the cosmological context. Please remember that as far as I know, because I never did cosmological simulations, but as far as I have been told by people doing numerical simulations, even in the context, say, of standard physics, the cosmological simulations are done by using Newtonian gravity. So in other words, people doing cosmological simulations are not integrating the general relativity equation. They are just integrating Newtonian equations. So this could be a very interesting experiment, for example, to start just with baryons and do a big cosmological simulation with mond gravity to see what we get. I have no idea. What I know, but this is just a personal, put in this way, quadratic guess. It's not just a guess, it's guess over a guess. What I know, because this part of the physics, the merge in mod is quite different. Why? Because in order to merge two galaxies, the relative velocity must be of the order of the velocity dispersions, the velocity dispersion of stars inside the galaxy. Because you need a lot of degrees of freedom that absorb the barycentric energy. If you move too fast, the galaxies just cross each other like two phantoms, because you cannot absorb energy. Okay, you have the regime that is called the shock, the impulsive approximation. And in MOND, a lot of merger, because the potential is logarithmic, will happen to very high relative velocity. So, if we believe that in order to explain the galaxy population we see around us, merging is the key word, I think with MOND, cosmology would have a lot of problems. I imagine that if you do a cosmological simulation with MOND, at the end you will have much less big galaxies than what we observe today. Because in Newtonian gravity, the relative velocity is not big, and galaxy, but in MOND, they just cross each other. So maybe the universe on galactic scale would be completely different. It would be a very interesting.
Turned out that in combination with neutrinos, MOND gives a power spectrum which apparently the data, it reproduces, it fits data okay, but in the third peak, the data is not clear enough, and it looks like the standard cosmology works better, but you need clearer data. And so apparently, better experiments will clarify this in the future, but when you look at it, it looks like standard cosmology is better, but it's still not good out there.
What's your name?
Stefan.
The Stefan point is very important, because it's exactly the frustration that when we work on MOND we have. We never found a very big example that MOND is wrong. You always find at the second order effect somewhere something that normal gravity works a little bit better. This is, so we are accumulating a lot of these disagreements, but without finding a big disagreement, we would be happy to say Bond is dead. Ah, So we stopped to think about that. We were not able. So, if that particular galaxy with no dark matter, I am talking against me, but I am am sure that if we take data and we measure the acceleration field of this object, this will be above 10 to minus 8. And model will predict that no dark matter should be found there. I am sure.
It's not a proof of inconsistency.
No.
But, I mean, just the fact that...
The only... Let me finish. So what's the real final word on mod is to have something below 10 to minus 8 without dark matter. When we will find the first stellar system with acceleration below to 10 to minus 8 without any evidence of dark matter, this is the final word for mod. But you need to be below 10 to minus 8. If you are above 10 to minus 8, like in the solar system, we are above 10 to minus 8. Except maybe at the edge of the solar system, where you have a pioneer that is moving outside Pluto. And if you look at pioneer, there is an anomalous acceleration in the orbit of pioneer, which seems to be related to 10 to minus 8. Centimeter for square second. Now at NASA they say they understand the problem. It's related to the back reaction of infrared photons from the cooling system. But for some reason, all these complicated emission of radiation acts like an acceleration of 10 to minus 8 centimeter per square second.
We are talking about Mond as if it is a well-defined theory.
It's not a well-defined.
Well, but the problem is it excessive to say that until you identify dark matter, you find its nature, you observe it,
in
a more traditional way, the idea of Mond is not really killed, because you have this dichotomy between a substance that is really existing in a modification of the physical world.
And I perfectly agree. We are all waiting for particle physicists to tell us what object is dark matter. But remember that astronomers, at least we identified the only case of dark matter was the planet Neptune. This was the first identification of dark matter. Because Uranus was moving strange, and people say, or is all the gravity, or there is unseen matter, and they discover Neptune. Unfortunately, we know that the dark matter in our galaxy cannot be made by planets, by free-floating planets, because you should have a lot of infrared emission, because planets are cold, but are not absolute zero. So you should have, they cannot be made by black holes. No, because if you take the mass of dark matter and you distribute in black holes, the systems of black holes becomes collisional, because the relaxation time, a system with less objects is more collisional. This was an old idea disproved by Martin Rees. They proposed black holes. I think in half an hour Martin Rees said it's impossible, because all the system of black holes should be collapsed by gravothermal catastrophe to the center of the galaxy. So dark matter must be made of very small objects, must be collisionless, absolutely, and particles must be quite slow. The temperature cannot be higher than 1 million Kelvin, because otherwise the halo will be dissolved by the potential wave of the galaxy. So the masses, they are slow moving particles. A few hundred kilometers per second, no more. So it's cold. Dark matter is cold, because if dark matter were hot, we could not have dark matter halos. So we know that it's collisionless. Otherwise, it would be completely collapsed, as we say. Cannot be bionic, because we observe in some spectral band, astronomers observe everything. And it cannot be made by the Oh, well, if particle physicists are able to produce
showing in rotational curves that in some cases they do have some glitches or features.
Yes, they are almost perfectly reproducible.
But yeah, but in case of dark matter, how can you explain the kind of because you know some illusion which is not uniform, which is not isothermal.
Some of these glitches you reproduce just because they are super Newtonian. And so the gravitational field is just produced by Poisson equation. In some other cases, the model works. And in Newtonian theory, people say, well, systems are never perfect. So because you have, in the gravitational field, you have also for these galaxies to add the mass contribution of gas, which is negligible in elliptical galaxies, but is not negligible in disk galaxies. So when you do a proper mass decomposition, not trivial. So you have fissures also in the gas distribution. But when you add everything, more the works.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Grazie, io credo che a 10 per accompagnare. Riesce a accompagnare.